Yes, indeed.
Today is the 100th anniversary of the birth of the great swing trombonist and bandleader Tommy Dorsey. By the end of the 30s, Tommy was well established as a bandleader in his own right, having broken free both of his elder brother Jimmy and of the Dixieland style of his first records. The main agent for this change was the brilliant arranger Cy Oliver, whom Dorsey recruited from the Jimmy Lunceford band and whose writing made Dorsey's the most African-American sounding of all the white big bands of the swing era. Oliver himself was featured as a vocalist on record, and as his fellow trumpeter Zeke Zarkey recalls, from time to time he took to the road with the band as well.
When we went on a road after the Palmer House doing one-nighters, Lee had some problem with his teeth and he left the band and went back to Chicago, and he was out for 3 weeks, and Cy took his place and sat right next to me for 3 weeks playing trumpet in the band. I loved him. I've loved that guy like I would love anybody, really. He was such a wonderful person to begin with and so talented, and I can't say any more.
Yes, indeed! Yes, indeed!
Get to making with Jive, boy, you shout when it hits you. Yes, indeed! Yes, yes. Yes, you shout when it hits you.
Yes, indeed!
When the spirit moves you, you shout hallelujah.
I mean,
when it hits you, you holler.
Yes, indeed!
Yes, yes. When the jazz start jumping, you shout.
Let me in there.
Well, all right. When it hits you, you holler.
Yes, indeed.
Yes, indeed.
A unique ingredient of the band's sound behind Cy Oliver's trumpet and the vocal he shared there with Joe Stafford was the drumming of Buddy Rich, as assertive with his fills on the cowbell and cymbal stand as he could be on the full kit behind the power of the entire orchestra. Buddy was only 22 when he joined, but as Zeke Zarkey recalls, he already had a powerful personality.
The first thing we noticed about Buddy was how great he played. He was a phenomenal player. He never learned to read music and never cared about learning to read music. The very first set was at 7 o'clock, and the bane of big bands to all the head waiters was that the band was too loud. People were eating, and they were just talking, having dinner. Consequently, all the big bands played soft music just for dinner music that we never played at other times of the night. When we would play that first set for about 45 minutes from 7 to 8 or something like that, Tommy wasn't even there. He'd be up in his dressing room. Buddy Rich never even played during that first dinner set. He sat there at his drums writing letters or reading a magazine. That was below him, playing that soft ballad stuff. But when Tommy came down, We started to really open up band-wise. You should hear Buddy then, you know. He's kicked that band right in the butt when he played.
Buddy Rich's feature with the Tommy Dorsey Band from July 1940. Buddy left the band briefly to do his war service, and his place was taken by the veteran Gene Krupa. But before long, Buddy was released to play again with Dorsey once the band began to specialise in entertaining the troops. Trombonist and arranger Nelson Riddle remembers one such concert in New Mexico where Rich's tough character came into direct conflict with his famously abrasive bandleader.
We made the flight in a B-24 bomber, which was, I think, about the first time I'd ever been airborne. And it was right at the height of the war, and all the bands that were still in existence were devoted to doing work for the Army and Navy for morale purposes. We left the airplane, and we got in a bus and headed for the field for rehearsal. And as we went down this long road to the airbase, on all the telephone poles there were posters, which the advance man, as they call him, had put up heralding the advance of Tommy Dorsey into this area and the fact he was going to play a big concert that night. Recently, Tommy had made a change in drummers, and Gene Krupa had either quit or been fired, and Buddy Rich, who had just returned from the Marines, was the new drummer. And unfortunately, the advance man had not had enough advance notice of this, so it said Tommy Dorsey and his orchestra featuring Gene Krupa on the drums. And after Buddy Rich had seen about 20 of these signs, he was fit to be tied. And he was furious. So we got to the field, and we started the rehearsal. I think there were some acts. Probably a USO troop was part of the deal. Probably a combination. Let's see, you wouldn't do a dancing in the middle of a field, so it must have been a big concert with Tommy doing some numbers and the USO people, singers or jugglers or whatever they were. And we got halfway through the rehearsal, and Buddy Rich slammed his sticks down. He says, I'm not going to play this whole night for Gene Krupa. He says, everybody thinks it's Gene Krupa, and I'm... He didn't come at it anywhere near as calculating as I am. He was just furious, and he walked off. And Tommy saw him, and he said, you better come back. And Buddy said, I'm not coming back. And Tommy said, you will not leave this field alive. So he came back.
Buddy Rich stayed for several years with Dorsey, and confronted with his bandleader's potential wrath, he held his formidable temper in check. But as his successor in the band, Louis Belson, told me, Buddy's later image as a grouchy martinet who rivaled Dorsey for temper and tantrums wasn't entirely accurate.
Buddy, deep down, was a softie. You had to get to know him. He really was. He enjoyed being with other drummers and talking old times and experiences and so forth. And he was a pussycat, like you say, and really. I know there's word out that he was always aggressive and angry and so forth. Well, I think that happens to all of us, maybe a little more so with him. But he really was a very kind-hearted young man and a great player.
With Cy Oliver's charts, Buddy Rich's drumming, soloists such as Yank Lawson, Jaime Scherzer, Babe Russin and Johnny Mintz, the wartime Dorsey Band was by any standards a remarkable jazz orchestra. But from his childhood, Dorsey had it instilled into him by his father that he was to be the best at whatever he did in music. He knew he needed a star attraction that would reach out to a public way beyond jazz fans and Lindy Hop dancers. As Zeke Zaki recalls, his opportunity came when some of his band members heard the new singer with Harry James, the young Frank Sinatra.
When Harry James played the Chicago Theater, a bunch of us went down there to catch the show, to catch Harry, who was a phenomenon in his own right. And this skinny kid, this is exactly what he was, a skinny kid, was up there singing with the band and stopping traffic. All the old ladies and everybody else wouldn't let him off the stage. It was a big hit. And so word got back to Tommy very quickly about this kid with Harry James. And Tommy was always looking for fresh talent in the vocal department. A vocalist in a big band was more or less somebody to illustrate or help a tune get more popular. A songwriter would write a tune, and there would be lyrics. Well, somebody's got to sing the lyrics. There are very few really good pop band singers, you know. And so Tommy instantly saw something that would enhance his band, and the rest is history.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart and mind embraces all day through. In that small cafe, the park across the way, the chill.